Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Sends everyone far away, and vast is the emptiness in the midst of the land. Even if a tenth part remain in it, it will be burned again, like a terebinth
because of your love and faithfulness.
For you have glorified your name
and in your word above all things.
When I called, you answered me.
You increased my strength within me.
All the kings of the earth will praise you, O Lord.
When they have heard the words of your mouth,
they will sing of the ways of the Lord.
That great is the glory of the Lord.
Do the Lord be high, though the Lord be high, he cares for the lowly.
He perceives the haughty from afar.
Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you keep me safe.
You stretch forth your hand against the fury of my enemies. Your right hand shall save me.
The Lord will make good his purpose for me.
O Lord, your love endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands.
Second reading is Paul's letter to the Philippians. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I have proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn have received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Once, while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, Jesus saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then Jesus sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let your nets down for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so that they both began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you'll be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
My lifelong love of animals comes, including the hilarious platypus and the blue-tongued skink. I think it all comes and has its origins in the hours I spent as a child watching Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom. For those not familiar with the show, it was a nature program, a precursor, of course, to today's Animal Planet channel. Now, I'm in Montgomery, Alabama in the 1950s. There's not a lot going on there, really. So we would tune in, and I would see the savannas of Kenya, the Great Barrier Reef of Australia, the jungles of Borneo, and I was fascinated as new creatures in their curious habitats appeared on our television screen. Particularly, I was fascinated by the elephant seals of Argentina. And I remember in particular one episode that focused on a mother and her newborn seal pup. Soon after birthing her baby, the mother, now famished, abandons the pup on the shore so she can go feed in the rich waters off the coast. Of course, after feeding, she returns to a different part of the beach and calls for her baby. All the other mothers have done the same, all returning about the same time. How in the world would each mother and baby find each other? Well, the camera follows this one mother as she calls to her pup and listens for the response. Following each other's voices and scents, soon mother and pup are reunited. And of course, the narrator explains that from the moment of birth, the sound and the scent from the pup are imprinted upon the mother. And the same is true for each pup. And guess what? That is how it is with God. We too are imprinted with the memory of God, and God is imprinted with the memory of us. And even if it takes a lifetime, we will find each other. We just heard this in another seaside encounter in the Gospel of Luke. Jesus stands along the lake as people push in closer and closer, all desperately hungry to hear the word of God. Now, it's the early days of Jesus' ministry, and Jesus, noticing the empty boats of some fishermen, hops into one of the boats, asking to be put out a bit from the shore. And then Jesus assumes the traditional posture of a rabbi. He sits down, and as Luke tells us, he continues his teaching from this seated position. And in due time, Jesus instructs Simon Peter, the owner of the boat, we find out, to find deeper waters, for there are plenty of fish in the sea. Now Simon, an experienced fisherman, and probably more than a little worn out from a fruitless night of fishing, considers Jesus' request, and though he knows better, Simon lets down his nets. So many fish, so many that the nets are strained and frayed at the edges. And so Simon calls for help from his buddies, and now there are two boats swamped with the catch of the day. How could this be? Amazed, frightened Simon, who will come to know this freak creature fisherman in ways he cannot yet imagine. He stands there among the largest haul imaginable, and he begs Jesus to depart. And what does Jesus say? Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people. And Luke continues, each one of them, Simon, James, and John, beached their boats, leaving all behind, and they followed Jesus. For Luke's community, the whopping fish tale, Jesus calling the first disciples, is very significant. They're all fisher folk. He calls to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Simon Peter and the Zebedee boys, James and John. Now, I must confess that for years, and for more than one sermon just as well, I personally have struggled with the sights and sounds of this seaside encounter. Because for one thing, I well know what the humid days along the Gulf Coast do to a wide, smelly net filled with flopping mullet. Once pulled ashore and tossed on that sun-bleached dock, they twitch in the sun, gasping for a bit of air as the gulls and the pelicans swoop and dive with an eye to an easy breakfast. Do I really want to catch people like fish? Do I want to be caught hook, line, and sinker in a smelly, waterlogged net? Do you? But then, I think it's important for us to revisit this scene in Luke's gospel for some help. Jesus calls, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately they leave their nets and follow Jesus. Simon Peter, James, and John did not fall in like robots or zombies, stumbling behind Jesus as if they were brainwashed. No, they were not brainwashed. Rather, they were compelled. Compelled because even in the midst of their day-to-day lives, they'd been wired, been waiting, perhaps without even knowing, to hear his voice. They, you see, had been imprinted with God. Belonging to God is not a matter of going limp in God's arms. We are called by God, and we have been imprinted to love, to serve, to heal, to forgive. We are called to imitate Christ and to make choices that resemble his. And notice, too, please, that God's imprint, Jesus' call, happens to fishermen squarely in the midst of what they already know what to do. That's the power of God. The power of God at work. The power of God is not dependent upon the credentials of those called. Take this passage, for instance. Most of us hear it, and if we can get past the smelly fish scales part, we may start worrying about whether we have what it takes to be a disciple. Could you do it? If a clear call were to come to you this afternoon, could you get up from your chair, walk out the door without taking your keys or turning off the lights? Could you abandon your grocery cart in front of the frozen food case of Ingles and set off for parts unknown without stopping to call home? That is more or less what they did. These first disciples. Someone, as far as we know, someone they had never seen before in their lives said, "Follow me." And they did. They did, leaving their families, their jobs, their homes behind in order to go with him. And guess what? It's just not the way things were done in those days. Rabbis did not seek students. Rather, students sought them. Teachers waited for people to come to them, and they interviewed them very carefully before deciding whether or not to take them on as disciples. Only the most promising students were allowed to stay on, in fact, the ones who showed a real aptitude for theology. no self-respecting rabbi would ever have gone out and recruit his own followers. And if he had, he wouldn't have picked the very first chaps he laid eyes upon. But by doing just that, Jesus sets himself apart from the other teachers of his time. He alone walks out among ordinary working people and chooses them without a single question to be his friends. It's so easy, I think. It's so easy to get ourselves all wrapped up, not unlike fresh fish and newspaper, come to think of it. To get ourselves all wrapped up in the what ifs of this story. What if I heard and didn't follow? Or didn't want to fish for people? Or don't have what it takes? But this powerful story is not about us. In this glorious season of Epiphany, we are reminded in every gospel on each and every Sunday of the power of God to birth love in this world. Even when we are odoriferous or tired or uncertain. Because the story, our story, is God's story. God, who has eternally imprinted upon us God's love and power. Now, sometimes following may mean staying at home. It may mean letting the hired servants go and taking care of Zebedee when he gets too old to fish. Sometimes following may mean casting the same old nets in a new way for a new reason. It may mean doing something different with the fish you catch or spending the money they bring in at the market in a new way. It may mean reorganizing the whole fishing business so that the drifters down at the pier have work to do and so that everyone who works receives a decent wage. It may mean doing less every day, not more, so that there's time to watch how the light changes on the water and how the happy fish leap out of it at dusk, happy to have outsmarted you one more time. The possibilities for following seem endless. Sometimes they will be big, no doubt about it. And sometimes they will be too small to mention, but it would be a mistake. It would be a mistake, my friends, to focus too hard on our own abilities to follow. Because by the lakeshore, or in the gap, or in the gorge, our lives have purpose beyond what we can even imagine. As Christ's hands and feet in the world, we become holy nets of love in service to the one who loves us all beyond imagining. So how about it? You want to go fishing? Stand and reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth,
of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made,
of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made.
For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified.
suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers of the people are all found on page 387 of the top order. Remembering especially in the Diocesan Prayer Cycle seminarians and all students, faculty, and staff involved in theological education, Father, we pray for the Holy Catholic Church.
Amen. Amen.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
Remembering Michael, our presiding bishop, Jose, our bishop, we pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
Remembering Joe, our president, Roy, our governor, we pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Remembering all those on our parish prayer list, have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
Praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in their heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us. We make alive in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Amen. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
everybody. Have a seat, please. Welcome, welcome. A beautiful, sunny, ice-free day. Hallelujah. Thank you for being here. Joanne Ellington has gone to a family funeral in South Florida, so thank you, choir, for stepping up. We're going to brag on you when she gets back, so thank you all. As you all know, we've had a number of funerals in the parish family in the past week or two. Linda, where are you, my friend? And Linda, come up for it, friend. Asked if she could offer some Thanksgiving, and I said absolutely. So the floor is yours, madame.
Well, I think we put him away in the style that he would want. But thank you, all of you, because I could not have done it without you, and you all stepped up so kindly, and I certainly appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Linda. Thank you, Linda. It is a privilege, as you all know, to be a part of a parish like this, and you're right, these folks step up. They stepped up yesterday again. We had a service commending unto God Alan Buford the husband of a fairly new member of Church of Transfiguration. And I shared with the 8 o'clock congregation, as a part of that liturgy, everyone was given a strip of colored paper, different colors. And as part of the liturgy, we created a long chain indicating or symbolic of links of love that were created by all those who came to mourn and grieve and offer thanks to God for Alan's life. And then Mary Lee was here, blessedly helping. So she got all the links chained up on this side, and I did on this side, and we stepped to the center, Marnie, who is the spouse of Alan, took the very last link and connected all the links together to make one long chain. Whereupon Mary Lee and Marnie and I came up to the altar and placed the chain there to be, as I said, symbolic of all the love in that space. But when Marnie glanced down, on one of the links, someone had just drawn a big old fat heart. Mm-hmm. And she was just taken back, wasn't she? Such a simple thing, right, Linda? Just
yes.
That heart, but that represents what you're saying too, the heartbeat of God's love represented here. So this is how big and how good God is. So then last night, Dawn, look back there, Dawn, there she is. And I'm going to ask you to come up now and do a little talk up. Come on. Worked with us saying, you know, we're going to do the bare necessities blessing this morning. And I said, well, would you just send me a little blurb so that I could talk about it at the 8 o'clock congregation, which she dutifully did. And that's what you have before you, the boxes and bags filled with the bare necessity items that, let it be said, even during a pandemic year, have been created with love, sewing, cutting, adding snaps and things. I'm told that more than one time there was a clandestine gathering in Ingalls parking lot passing off things. But Dawn, if you would share a little bit about what the ministry is about, and then I have the things that I'll finish up with. So go ahead.
Sure. So this ministry, I took over the coordination year and a half ago, was begun by Laura and Amy Spangers of the church, and it's a ministry that really ministers to women and children all over the world for feminine hygiene care and child care diaper kits. We make feminine hygiene and reusable diaper kits, and through the years have sent them to 4 continents locally, and we've just been very blessed to keep that ministry going. And in a year, last year, when nobody was really traveling, and traveling is still very tough, we were very blessed to have some connections that are going to help us ship these to Haiti, to an Alpha Omega medical missions team of Vladimir Russo is the doctor there. And he works with the Sisters of Mercy out of Asheville. They usually travel down there, but they've been unable to do so. So we're going to ship those down there so that the women and children will be blessed. And what Anne has there in her hand is a basket of markers. And I started with my nephew last night when we were staging, writing messages from the church and prayers on those boxes and verses. And we'd like to invite everyone after the service to come and add your thoughts, your wishes, your prayers to those boxes so that they will travel with to them.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much. Haiti, so devastated, just again, not too long ago. So thank you for your ministry, all you participate in the bare necessities as well. To offer God's blessing on these before they depart our shores, I would like to ask you to turn to page 815 in the prayer book. Actually, we're going to pray the prayer that begins on 8:14, but what I want to show you on 8:15, the very top prayer, about halfway down, you'll see there's some brackets. It says, especially for those whom our prayers are desired. Everybody see that? If you don't, raise your hand, because you're not an old school mom. Okay. Halfway down the page, on page 8:15, the sentence begins, finally we commend to thy fatherly goodness. And then there's some brackets.
The very top paragraph, almost to the bottom of that top paragraph.
Yeah. But take your time. Make sure you find it. Because especially for those, we will say, especially for those who are to receive these bare necessities. Okay? Everybody see it? And if you don't see it, it's okay, because you don't go to the back of the prayer book very often. And then, as Dawn said, here's some markers. And after the service, after our concluding hymn, I'm going to put the markers up on the altar rail there. And so just come at your leisure, a few at a time. Even if it's just a heart or a cross or something. We're just going to bling up these boxes with love. So thank you again, Dawn. So we're going to begin with the prayer on 8:14, which says, for all sorts and conditions of men. This is one of the oldest prayers in our prayer book, too, by the way. Captured again for us today. So let us pray with one another. O God, the Creator and Preserver of all mankind, we humbly beseech thee for all sorts and conditions of men, that thou wouldst be pleased to make thy ways known unto them, thy saving health unto all nations. Most especially we pray for thy holy church universal, that it may be so guided and governed by thy good spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. Finally, we commend to thy fatherly goodness all those who are in any ways afflicted or distressed in mind, body, or estate, especially those who receive these bare necessities, that it may please thee to comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their sufferings, and a happy issue out of all their afflictions. And this we beg for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. And may we walk in love as Christ first loved us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because of the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. The night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with Simon Peter and James and John and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom.
Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you. Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always.
Amen.
Sing the wonder.